When one of my brothers told me that my mother had gone straight to Denmark the moment she learned that she was ill, that they had not managed to speak to her in earnest before she left, to talk to her properly, to offer her the appropriate words of comfort, I made a quick decision and a quick telephone call, and precisely 2 days after her arrival, I too reached the North Jutland port early in the morning on the old and unfailing maligned ferry, the Holger Danske. I had overslept, I had missed breakfast in the cafeteria, and a woman was standing outside banging the door to my cabin. "We've docked," she shouted. "We've docked already. Get yourself up," she shouted, and banged the door, and for a moment I wondered if she was one of those women I had made friends with in the bar the night before. The small bar had been jam-packed when yesterday evening was slowly sliding into damp night, and most of them were men in that bar, but a few women were there too, though not so many as there would have been today, and I had talked at length with several of them. I thought they were pretty. It was a tight squeeze for anyone wanting to drink. Those of us who badly wanted to were crammed together as we carefully held our cigarettes between the fingers of one hand while holding a beer or a double whiskey tied to our chest with the other, maneuvering the glass very slowly up past the shirt collar and chin to swallow every precious drop. There was a man there I did not like. I did not like his face when he looked at me. It was as if he knew something about my person that I myself was not aware of, which for him was clear as day, as if I were standing there naked, with no control over what he saw, nor could I see in his eyes what he saw in mine. But what he saw and what he knew made him feel superior to me, and in some strange way I felt he had a right to. It could not be true. I had never seen him before. I was certain of that. He didn't know anything about my life. But his gaze seemed all-knowing and patronizing each time he turned in my direction, and he often did. It made me uneasy. I could not concentrate, and once when he shoved past me on his way to the gents or perhaps down to his cabin to fetch something he might have left down there, he barged into my shoulder in a way I found provocative. Some of the beer in my glass sloshed over the shirt I had bought only days before and considered pretty smart. I was convinced he had bumped into me on purpose, and it made me feel threatened. In fact, I feared for my life. I don't know why, but I got scared. I put down my beer on the bar and left. First, I made for the deck to clear my head, and it was dark there along the railing when I pushed open the heavy door and stepped outside. Lifeboats were hanging like zeppelins above me in the vanishing light from the corridor I had left, and behind me the door slammed shut with an ominous bang. I could hear the sound of the sea and the wind sweeping along the ferry as she made her way through the waves. They were not tall, but nor was it calm. It was November and cold. The Holger Danske listed gently from side to side in the black night, where only the white spume on the crests of the waves near to the ship could be seen and the glow of my cigarette. It tasted vile. I thought maybe I was going to throw up, but the power of the sea was not stronger than my body could handle. So I flicked the cigarette across the railing, out into the wind, and it hit the hull and burst into sparks before it was lost in the dark. I stepped carefully back until I felt the cold wall touch my shoulder, and I leaned against it and stood there staring until my eyes got used to the dark. I felt better. We had passed the Farder lighthouse. There was open sea to both sides, and the sea, it was like an old friend. And then it suddenly struck me that the man from the bar might come out here, and if he did, I was done for. He was bigger than me and could easily have thrown me overboard if he felt like it, and then I would be gone forever, and no one would know exactly where. The thought grew so powerful I had to leave the deck, though many times I have stood like that in the night, looking out over the sea. There is a calm there to be found, which at times I have badly needed. With some effort, I managed to open the heavy door that the wind pushed hard against its frame, and I walked along the corridor and down the stairs to my cabin. I had barely sat down on the bed to take off my shoes when there was a loud knock on the door. For a moment there, I literally froze with fear. I slowly stood up. I didn't know what to do. I stood listening, and there was a second knock, a sharp, dry sound, and then I suddenly knew exactly what to do. I clenched my right fist hard and walked a few steps to the door, tore it open, and lashed out. The corridor was dim and I could not see his face. In fact, I could not see a damn thing. But I hit him on the jaw, right below the ear. I could feel it on my hand, and he crashed into the opposite wall. More from the shock than the force of my blow, I guessed. But as I slammed the door shut and quickly double-locked it, I felt a stinging pain in my knuckles. I stood there, listening, holding my breath, but there was no sound from the corridor, and I stood there a bit longer, but it was still quiet, and I lay down on my bed and kept listening until I could not stay awake any longer, and I fell asleep, and in the early morning, a woman was banging on my door. We've talked already, get yourself up, she cried. And it seemed as if what had happened only a few hours earlier had taken place in a dream I was already starting to forget. But my hand was still sore, and I could barely open it or clench it.